I know that some of you are trying to get on the road today, and I just appreciate you coming. I appreciate youth workers, you taking time to bring your young people. Pastors, thank you for taking time to come. I can tell you that my life was changed in places like this through the years, and I didn't necessarily appreciate it as much as I should have when I was a teenager, because I didn't really know the value of it. But as I've gotten older, I look back on all those youth workers through all those years that I did such terrible things to and drove crazy. And I'm just thankful that they put up with me and they love me and they took me to places like this and they gave me swirlies in the hotel room, you know? And how many of you know what a swirly is? Anybody know what a swirly is? A swirly is when you stick somebody's head in the toilet and then flush it. And that, you know, it just kind of like curls their hair out like a unicorn. It's great. And I literally had a youth worker one time in a hotel room on a trip to Boston, Massachusetts when I was in seventh grade. He got so upset with me, I was annoying him. Seventh graders are just the most annoying people on the planet. And seventh graders, I'm not busting on you, seventh graders. You just can't help it. Like, when you turn in seventh grade, like, your brain dies. And it's like a caterpillar. It's a caterpillar. It's a caterpillar. Your brain dies when you turn in seventh grade. It's like, it's just over. And it crawls into this little cocoon. And it's a cocoon of, I think I'm really funny, but I'm not cocoon. And so then seventh graders just like annoy everybody, and somewhere in the line, and just different times depending on what kind of person you are, but somewhere along the line, your brain emerges as a beautiful butterfly. Some of you, it came back out like the caterpillar, but we give you that. It's okay. But seventh graders, but I had a youth worker one time literally hang me on the back of the hotel bathroom door by my underwear. He did. He picked me up, hooked the back of my underwear on the door, and I'm hanging on the back of the door, and he just closed it and went about his business. And I'm like, you know, hanging there, you know, it's terrible. But that's what youth workers are for. They will change your life. Amen. He changed my life. I don't recommend it, but it worked for me. I quit annoying that guy. But I thank the Lord for youth workers. I'm so thankful for the people that influenced my life. And you know, it's amazing as a pastor. Now I look back and, you know, we oftentimes listen, and I want to just encourage you with this too, youth workers, because I'm just telling you from my perspective, I grew up in this. And I look back now as a pastor and I think about I've heard some of the greatest messages. I've heard some of the greatest preachers in my life. I've been in independent Baptist churches for 43 years. That's how old I am. I know that's a surprise. I mean, you saw me dunk, right? And I could have done it the first time. I just don't want to make the other guys look bad. And so I waited till all that was kind of done and we had a winner and then I threw one down. So I just wanted you to know that I'm still like, my athletic prowess is amazing at 43. But I'm just saying, Brother Jake, you couldn't dunk and I did it. But anyway, how you like me now? So, but I've heard some of the greatest preachers of all time. I mean, the greatest preachers. But I'll tell you this. There's a lot of those people that we went to hear preach, and they preach great, and God used it in my life. But when I look back at some of the times where God did a work in my heart, it was with one of my youth workers, a layman in the church, that over the years of being faithful, their life preached so much louder than some of the greatest messages I heard. And so I just want to encourage youth workers, you stay faithful and pray and love and give. And you kids, you find some faithful people and you watch them. You know, I'll come to town and I'll preach a message and I'm going back to Mississippi. And they're going to put up with you for the next 5 years, 6 years, 7 years. Some of you like 8, 9, 10 years, you know, before long they're like, would you just please go to the college and career class, you know? But I'm in seventh grade. But you're 19. But I'm in seventh grade. Okay. So, does that happen up here too? Is that just Mississippi? Anyway, I'm just kidding. But I just appreciate you being here. And I really will pray that we get out on time and that you can get back on the road and that you don't have any breakdowns on the way home. Because that is a horrible, horrible situation to be broke down on the side of the road. I've got so many memories. Some of my greatest memories are somewhere under an overpass. Waiting on the other bus to come pick us up. I was on the bus one time when I was like in seventh grade, and I don't know why I did this. I was such an idiot. I'd always like, I would get on the bus and I would sit by the window and I would lean my head against the window on a school bus. I'm just telling you, seventh graders, I'm gonna get my head in the window, and every time I would leave, there'd be like a big grease spot on the window because my oily skin, you know, my head, or probably I didn't wash my hair either, I don't know. Seventh graders, I don't know what's going on, but I've got my head on the window of the bus, and those buses, every bump they hit, it's like, oh, you know? I'd like look at the window like, man, and then I go right back to it, you know? You know, I come home, I got a black eye. My mom's like, are those boys beating up on you? No, it was the bus, you know? I remember one time sitting on the bus like that, we're driving on the road like, and I'm like, I look out the window and there is a tire bouncing down at a high rate of speed down the interstate. And I'm like, hey, somebody lost a tire. It was our bus lost the tire. We're sliding down the road. Our wheels came off. Our bus is flying down the road. This is in Colorado. The sparks set the ditch on fire on the side of the interstate. So our bus comes to a stop. The whole ditch is on fire. Our youth pastor doesn't even care if we're alive. He's like, everybody grab your coats. We gotta put the fire out. We're on the side of the highway beating on the fire. When we finally got to camp, my sleeping bag had burn holes in it. It was unbelievable. The terrible things. We broke down one time in Iowa. Way out in the middle of nowhere. If anybody's ever been to Iowa, Iowa has nothing but cornfields. As far as the eye can see is cornfields. And we broke down in our bus out in the middle of nowhere in Iowa. And there was a little, thank God for it, our youth pastor limped the bus over, and there was a little church in town. He got a hold of him back, you know, he was looking in the phone book. That's a book that we used to have that had numbers in it. So, it had people's phone numbers. He found the church, he found the pastor, he called the pastor. The pastor came down and let us in the church. And the church was like a little tiny shotgun-style church. It was like one section of pews like this that went back. Just a little tiny building. And the church sat on about 6 or 7 acres that were all mowed. There's a little highway in front of the church, and there was like a little areas around the church that were mowed. But on all three sides of the church, guess what was growing? Corn on all three sides of the church. And so we were in there, and they're trying to fix our bus. And so the boys, man, we're out there playing football. I think I was like in eighth or ninth grade. We're out there playing football. And we're there for like 2 days. And the second day we're there, I am so tired. I am so tired. It is hot. It is humid. We've played so much football. I'm like, I'm going to go on a walk. So I told my buddy, I said, hey, I'm going to go walk. And he said, where are you going to go? I'm like, I don't know. I'm going to go look at the corn. And he's like, okay. So I walk back there, and I'm looking at all the cornfields, and we're looking down all the rows of the corn. And I'm like asking my buddy, you know, do you think there are people that live in the corn? And like little creatures that run around and like eat people and stuff. He's like, I don't know. So we're looking for the people that live in the corn, and we're walking down. We get all the way to the back of the property, and we're walking down across the back cornfield. There's a little barbed wire fence. It's all sagging down. And we're walking down, and I don't have a really good smeller. Like, I don't smell good, but I smell pretty good. But I mean, I don't have a good sense of smell. But I've got really good hearing because I got giant ears. And I just can't smell really good. So we're walking down, and I'm like, hey, do you hear that? And my buddy's like, do you smell that? Well, I can't smell what he smells, but I can hear, like, I hear all this buzzing, like, and he smells something weird. And I'm like, so we're walking closer, and I'm like, what is it? He's like, I don't know, man. That thing stinks. So we get up there a little further down the road, and on the other side of the fence in the cornfield is this giant, dead, bloated cow. And it's laying there. It's laying there, and it is so bloated you can hardly even see like its legs and its hooves. Its legs are out stiff like this, and it's just giant bloated. And its eyes are all glassy, and its tongue's hanging out, and it's laying on its back just like, right? And my buddy goes, "Whoa! Look at that cow!" And I'm like, "Man, that thing is swollen." He goes, "Yeah." This is what my buddy said. He said, it looks like it's gonna pop. And then I had an idea. And I said to my buddy, it is gonna pop. He's like, when? I said, right now. How do you know? Because we're going to pop it. He stepped back and he looked at me and then he asked this question. Have you ever popped a cow before? I'm like, did you just formulate that as a sentence and spit it out there? Like, think about that. Have you ever popped a cow before? Oh, yeah. Last week I popped a cow. Oh, wait a minute. That was an elk. I popped an elk. No, I've never popped a cow before. But here is a cow that needs to be popped. It's a chance of a lifetime. So I'm looking around, and my buddy that I grew up with, he was like really, really inquisitive. He was kind of a nervous kind of guy, you know, real nervous. And he made straight A's in school, and I did too because I sat right behind him. But but he was really nervous kind of kid, you know, and he was just like, so I'm like looking around for something. He's like, so what happens when you pop a cow? I'm like, I don't know, Brian. He goes, boom. And he goes, like, but I mean, like, is it like a big explosion? I'm like, yeah, it's going to be huge, like, boom. And I said, it's going to be loud. And he's like, well, what's going to happen to us? I said, Brian, I don't know. We're probably going to die. I said, in my mind, look at that cow. When that cow pops, I'm talking about crater, mushroom cloud. We're going to be deaf first. And then we're going to die. So we won't even hear it coming. Then we're going to fall in the crater. Our buddies are going to run over, and they're going to see us laying in a pile of guts in this crater, and they're going to be like, what happened? And the forensic scientists are going to come out and test everything, and they're going to be like, whoa, these guys died from a popped cow. And I said, when they announce that in our autopsy reports, we are going to be heroes, because that is a cool way to die. Like, I don't want to be like, I don't want to get older one day and like, hey, how did your grandpa die? And my grandkids are like, well, he slipped and fell in the shower, you know? That's why I don't understand why old people drive like 5 miles an hour. You're dying. Let's go. Like, you ain't got much time. Beep, beep, beep. But I mean, listen, just put the pedal on the right down and go. Like, I do not, I don't want to be that grandpa. Like, oh, man, you know, well, he just, you know, died. He fell over and broke his hip or something. When I get older, I'm going to get a Corvette and I'm going to fly. I want my grandkids to be like, man, how did your grandpa die? He flipped his vet doing 110, man. He was awesome. The best grandpa ever. Really, what caused him to flip it? He hit a cow. And the crazy thing was, the cow was out in the pasture. It was dead, and he ran over it. Grandpa was awesome. So I'm like, okay, Brian, so I find this stick, and I got it. And so, like, I'm more analytic. Like, okay, how do I do this? You know, like, how does it need to be done? And I'm thinking, you know, I've got a basketball at home that's 100% leather, and it's full of air, and it's really hard. And so, I mean, you got to really, if you were going to pop that, you'd have to hit it hard. And this cow is 100% leather and full of air. So I got to hit it hard, too. It's a ninth grade logic. So I look at my buddy, I'm like, okay, I got my strategy, man. I know exactly how I'm going to do it, man. I'm going to, I got to get the hips in it. I mean, yeah, you got to get that thing. So I turn around to my buddy and go, are you ready? And he goes, okay. So I really don't even know why, because I still can't figure it out. But like, I was sneaking up on a dead cow. Right? And the cow just like, I don't know what I was expecting. Like the cow, like when I got close, the cow got up. Because that's what I'm thinking, like, if human ghosts say boo, cow ghosts have to say moo, you know? was an utterly great joke. I'm going to milk that one for all it's worth. But speaking of that, who were the first two people that were sitting there one day looking at a cow? Hey, Jeb? Yeah? You see them hangy things on the back of that cow? Yeah, I see them. Suppose I was to walk over there and give that thing a yank. Would you drink whatever came out of there? Give her a shot, Bill. All right. I'm a mosey on over there. I wonder who the first person thought of that was. Anyway. So I'm sneaking up on this dead cow. My buddy's in full ready position. I get right up on the cow, right? And so I got to hit this thing hard. So I rear back. I mean, I give everything I got. There's a little fence right between us. And when I hit the cow, you don't have to hit it hard. So my momentum is like, now I didn't fall in, but that little fence kind of helped me like just get right over the blowhole. Because when that stick hit that skin, it went like, it just folded. It just like folded in. And in my mind, I can still see everything. That skin just kind of like broke away. There was like ripples. It just kind of broke away. And there was like this little sound of like a swooshing sound inward, like a suction. And then it was just like that. So in the sequence of things, it was sneak, 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 like that. Well, I don't have a weak stomach. I mean, I've done everything. I've eaten everything at camp. I mean, it's just, I don't have a weak stomach. But when that moist, hot air hit me in the face, it was like, I didn't even have to think about it. It was automatic. It was boom. So I turned around, and my buddy's like, ha, 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 ha. So we take off running. We're like, ha, 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 bleh, ha, 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 bleh. And back into the things like. We got back over to where all the guys were playing football, and they were like, what's that smell? My buddy's like, he popped a cow. There were no showers in that church. So we were in the sink, like with the little soap dispenser. Like. My buddy's like, how am I gonna get this out of my hair? I'm like, here, come here. There you go. So I'm just telling you, if on the way home, you see something on the side of the road, dead. It could be like a raccoon, a possum, a hitchhiker. Do not pop it. You will live to regret that. Somebody one time told me and said, hey, has anybody ever told you that you were lying when you told that story? I said, all the time, everywhere I go, people will tell me, oh, that didn't happen, because if that cow was dead and bloated, it was too stinky to get close to. And I was in Conway, Arkansas, and there was a man in your church that has like a dairy farmer or something, Brother Nate, and he came to me and he goes, has anybody ever told you you were lying? I said, yes. He goes, well, I know you weren't lying. Do you know why that cow died? And I said, no. He said, because that cow had been eating green corn. And he said, so that cows don't have the ability to get rid of gas as fast as we do. You must have a great ability to get rid of gas. He's like, oh, I do. I know. That's why when you sit in church, you always sit in your own pew. You know what I'm saying? But we won't go there. So anyway, so that cow was just full of gas. So basically, you know what that cow did to me. You don't want to go there ever with a cow. But I'm thankful that we're going to pray that you make it home tonight without any problems, all right? No detours. Daniel chapter 3. Look at Daniel chapter 3. Daniel chapter 3. I have three girls. I don't want to exclude the girls, but I'm going to talk about three guys today. But I don't want to exclude the girls because this applies to the girls too. I've got three girls, Deanna, Brianna, and Juliana. Deanna is 19. She flew out today to leave for college. I had to say my goodbyes to her yesterday, and then they flew out today to go to college. And my middle daughter, Brianna, she's a senior in high school. And then I have my youngest daughter, Juliana. Raise your hand down here, Juliana. Juliana's with me down here. She's 13. And so I got Deanna, Brianna, Juliana. If we ever have a boy, we're going to name him Santa Anna. So we're really hoping for that. But I've got three girls, and that's a whole different ball game, raising girls. And I'm just say real quick to all the girls, okay? All you girls, if you ever decide that you're gonna make a makeup tutorial on YouTube or Instagram or whatever, can you start it in a different way without saying, "Hi guys." Like every single one is like, "Hi guys. I just wanted to tell you about this new stuff. It's called Too Faced. And if you put this on," every one of them was like, "Hi guys. Hi guys. Hi guys." Okay, guys are not watching that, I hope. I'm just throwing that out there. That's one of my pet peeves. Whenever I watch makeup tutorials, I just get tired of that. And as a dad of girls, I've watched a lot of makeup tutorials. Daniel chapter 3, verse number 1, Nebuchadnezzar. We call him Nebuchadnezzar, but I never knew how to pronounce that. I had to spell it in school, so I used to pronounce it Nebuchadnezzar. That way I could spell it. Nebuchadnezzar the king made an image of gold whose height was 60 cubits and the breadth thereof 6 cubits, and he set it in the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon. 60 cubits is 60 cubits high. It was 60 cubits high and 6 cubits wide. Nebuchadnezzar was a type of the Antichrist in the Old Testament. He was a type of the man. He's the type of the man who will very soon be on the scene in our world, who will be the world leader that will turn the hearts of the people against God and make himself God, and he will rule the world by being a dictator. He will rule the world by consolidating and making a one-world government, a one-world money, a one-world religion, and he will consolidate this world. And by the way, the world is heading to that very quickly. The Antichrist will be on the scene very soon after Jesus comes. And Nebuchadnezzar is a type of that. And Nebuchadnezzar the king sent to gather the princes. Now look at verse number 2. He sent to gather the princes, the governors, the captains, the judges, the treasurers, the counselors, the sheriffs, and all the rulers of the province to come to the dedication of the image which Nebuchadnezzar the king had set up. Now he set up this thing that was 60 cubits high, 6 cubits wide, and it stood out there as a big image of him. It was a golden statue of him. And he set this big image up. And he called everybody to come worship it. Now you gotta understand, Nebuchadnezzar was the king of Babylon. Babylon controlled the whole world. They were the great world empire. And so he called all these province leaders, the judges, the sheriffs, the governors, and all these people came from all over the world to come to this place of Dura to worship this big image. And the Bible repeats things. Now listen, God is not repeating. When you read Daniel chapter 3, it almost sounds like it's a high school student who's trying to finish that 1,000-word essay. When the teacher gives you a 1,000-word essay and you're writing it, "My summertime was very, 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 very fun. We went on a very, 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 very long trip. I was very, 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 very tired when we got there. So I slept for a very, 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 very..." And then you're like word counting it. Oh, man, 75. Well, that's what it seems like Daniel's doing, but he's not. God is repeating things on purpose. Look at verse 3. "Then the princes, the governors, the captains, the judges, the treasurers, the counselors, the sheriffs, the rulers of all the provinces were gathered together in the dedication of the image that Nebuchadnezzar the king set up. And they stood before the image that Nebuchadnezzar had set up. Then a herald cried aloud. To you it is commanded, O people, nations, and languages, that at what time you hear the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harp, sackbut, psaltery, dulcimer, and all kinds of music, you shall fall down and worship the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar the king set up. And whoso falleth not down and worship, the same hour shall be cast into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. Therefore, at that time, when all the people heard the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, and all kinds of music, all the people in nations and languages fell down and worshiped the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar the king had set up. Wherefore, at that time, certain Chaldeans came near and accused the Jews. Now, who are the Jews? The Jews are the people of God. Everybody with me on that? So who are the Jews? The Jews are the people of God. And so these Chaldeans came and accused these Jews, the people of God, for not bowing down to the image. They came near and spoke to the king in verse number 9. They said unto the king Nebuchadnezzar, O king, live forever. Thou, O king, hast made a decree that every man shall hear the sound of cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, and dulcimer, and all kinds of music, shall fall down and worship the golden image. And whoso falleth not down and worshipeth, that should he be cast in the midst of a burning fiery furnace. There are certain Jews. Now, who are the Jews? So we can say there are certain of God's people whom thou hast set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, have not regarded thee. They serve not thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. Then Nebuchadnezzar, in his rage and fury, commanded to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And they brought them before the king. And the king said unto them, Is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Do you not serve my gods, nor worship the golden image that I have set up? Now, if ye be ready, that at that what time ye hear the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, and dulcimer, and all kinds of music, ye fall down and worship the image which I have made, well. But if ye worship not, ye should be cast the same hour into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. And who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hand? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said unto the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer thee in this matter. If it be so, our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace. And he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. But if not, our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace and will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. But if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. Then was Nebuchadnezzar full of fury, and the form of his visage, that's his face, was changed against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Therefore he spake. That means he did this. He put his mad face on. Do you have a mad face? A face when you make. So he changed his face. Now he's ticked off, got the wrinkled nose, blood veins sticking out. Like when my dad got mad, I could always tell my dad got mad. He was always kind of very calm. When my dad got mad, there was a blood vein right here, and it would like pop out. And dad would look at you, and if you saw that blood vein, like, you were like, okay. Dad is like 30 seconds away from killing us. Nobody move. The T-Rex cannot see motion. Dad, man, my dad, when he got mad, he would spank us. He would like, go to your room and get ready for a spanking. So we would like go to our room and we would sit in there. What we didn't know is dad was giving himself some time to cool down. So dad would cool down. And then dad would walk down the hallway. And dad wore cowboy boots. He'd walk down the hallway, and there was a board like halfway between in the hallway. And when he would step on it, he'd be like, arr. Like we would hear dad like clunk, clunk, clunk. Like, oh, we're gonna die. Then my dad would come in the room and he would shut the door and he would stand in front of us. We're sitting on the bed looking up at dad. Dad was standing in front of us. And dad would reach down and he would unbuckle his belt. And dad was a cowboy, so he always had that big leather belt. Dad would reach down and grab that belt, and he goes, boys, you know what you did was wrong. And he'd pull that belt out. That sound of the belt coming out of the loop still gives me shivers. Like, when I'm at home, I have to take my belt out, like, really, really slow. Because if I forget something, I'm like, oh! Dad's like, then he would fold it over. He's like, now you know you did wrong, don't you? And he would open it, and then he'd go, pow! And the belt was making like a piranha face. It was like, Dad was like, you know what you did, don't you? Yeah. So then my dad would just tell us, okay, now bend over the bed and bite the pillow. We always thought that Dad was making us bite the pillow because of, you know, the, just take it like a man, you know? But no, he was making us bite the pillow because he didn't want the social, he didn't want the neighbors to hear us yelling and call social services to come take us away. You bite the pillow. And then Dad would be like, you're gonna get three. And Dad had a rule. When he hit, when he smacked you right there, Dad would always, you know, he'd get you right, right, yes. Pow. And he was like, if you put your hands back, we start over. I made that mistake one time, like, oh, pow. You know? And I'm walking around like a cripple guy. Yeah. I got like T-Rex hands and go, and then we start over. And Dad would hit you, whack. Now, I don't know, some of you maybe never got a spanking, but when Dad would hit you, that belt would pop like that. And listen, I'm just telling you, it would sting so bad, you can't cry. Right? You're like, pop. So then Dad's thinking, oh, I didn't hurt. He's not even crying. Whack! Then he hit you again, and by that time you're like, whoa! And then, I mean, you're just like, and then he's like, oh, that's out of control. Whack! And then he wants to have prayer. You know, it's a sit down. I can't sit down. Dad, when you pray, would you pray that I would be able to sit down? Then you got to go back out to the supper table, and you don't want your brothers to think that, you know, it really had effect. So you come in and you like try to slide into your chair. You're like, yeah. Yeah, I'm going to just kind of do squats and some lat work on this chair. Oh, man, it would hurt so bad. And then I hated it because you're trying to be cool in front of your brothers. I had two older brothers trying to be cool in front of them. And you're like, it didn't hurt that bad. But, you know, you have the subs. And that always gives you away. You're like, yeah. Those subs always give you away. Now, my mom didn't spank like that. You know, my dad would always be like, go to your room and get ready for spanking. And I never understood that. And like one day, I knew I was in trouble. Dad was going to kill me. I'm like, man, I should have obeyed. So I'm on the way to the room. I'm like, okay, I got to obey now. What did Dad just say? Dad just said to go to your room, get ready for a spanking. He always says that. And I'm never ready. I've never been ready for a spanking. So I'm in my room like, how do I get ready for a spanking? So then when my dad came in this time, I was ready. My dad opened the door and I had every pair of underwear, every single pair of my sweatpants. I had my snowsuit on. I'm standing there like, with a smile on my face, and my dad's like, what are you doing? I figured it out. I got ready for a spanking. I am like totally ready. Give me your best shot. Go ahead. Let me have it. I can't feel anything. Just let me have it. If you knock me down, though, you gotta help me up. I can't get up. I'm a genius. But my mom, she didn't spank like that. My mom would just, like somewhere in the middle of the thing, she would be like, boys, knock it off, boys, knock it off, boys, knock it off. And we just keep pushing, and somewhere mom would just like, and she would reach around and grab you. She'd snatch you, sometimes by the arm, sometimes by the hair, sometimes like two fingers out of your nose, come here. And then my mom would just grab whatever was around, right? It didn't matter, like curling iron, like pan, frying pan, it didn't matter. And like one time she grabbed my brother and she's like spanking me with my brother. My brother's like, what did I do? And my dad would give you three or four, whatever, but my mom, she spanked us in syllables. Didn't I tell you not to do that? I told you not to hit your brother. Wait till your father gets on me. Mom, call him dad. Father, dad, that's Wes one. She'd be like, chasing around. Psh, psh, psh. Some of you kids have no idea what I'm talking about right now. And that's, you need one. I have no idea why I started talking about that, but let's go back to the Bible.
So here's Nebuchadnezzar builds this giant image of himself. He brings all the governors, all the sheriffs, everybody together. So we're going to bow down and worship this. If you don't bow down and worship this, we're going to throw you in the fiery furnace. So now I'm going to get the flute and the harp and the psaltery and the sackbut and all these different dulcimer and all these different instruments and all kinds of music. And when you hear that, you have to fall down and worship the image. Well, then everybody, when they heard it, fell down. But there were three boys there, three young men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who had been taken out of Israel when they were young and brought as captives to Babylon. And they had been good young men, and Nebuchadnezzar had given them some positions with Daniel, but when they all went to the ground, those boys stood up. And so some people said, hey, these guys aren't bowing down. So they brought him before Nebuchadnezzar and said, Nebuchadnezzar, these boys aren't bowing down. He said, what's wrong with you? He said, if you don't do that, I'm going to throw you in the fire. Do you understand? And they said, hey, our God's able to deliver us. But if not, we're still not going to bow down and worship your gods. So then he got his angry face. That's where we were. He got his angry face on. And he said, if you don't do it, I'm going to throw you in. I'm going to heat this up 7 times hotter and throw you in. Now you get out there and you fall down and worship me. And here's three boys that were facing the fire. Here's three boys that were facing extinction. There were three boys that were about to die. I want you to understand something. In our generation today, and in your generation, the time is going to come that I believe to take a stand for Jesus Christ is going to cost you something. Now, I mean, we're still living in a pretty good time in our country, and we can preach what we want and say what we want, and we can go where we want and believe what we want, and we may get a few persecutions, and we may get somebody to answer us back on Twitter or Facebook or whatever, and they might blast us or call us radicals or whatever, and they might unfollow us. They might slam a door in our face. They might even leave our church. But these boys were facing the fire. And I want a group of young people to leave and go back to your church, ready for whatever the world brings you, whatever Satan brings you. I want some young people in this generation that can say, this is what we believe. We own it. It's ours. And no matter what the world does and what they say, we are not going to bow down and go the way the world's going. Now, I want to give you some things that you're going to have to think for just a second to lay the understanding of this. Because I want to teach you how the devil works. I want to teach you how the world works for a second. Let me show you how the world is going to change your thinking. The first thing the world's going to do to get you to change your thinking. Now listen to me, the world has changed our thinking on everything. Yeah. They think that when a woman is pregnant and doesn't want to have that baby, they think that she can go to the doctor and have a procedure and remove some tissue. That's the way they think. She can remove some tissue from her body. What she's really doing is she's murdering the baby. But you see how they change that. See, and the other thing is this. When a young man and a young woman who aren't married want to get physical with each other, the world says that's okay. They're experimenting, they're in love, they need to explore, it's okay. They just need to practice safe sex. That's what's taught in your public schools. Well, can I tell you something? The way God made that between a husband and wife, it's not supposed to be unsafe. Let me just tell you what the world wants you to do when they tell you that. The world's sexual education system today is telling you this. They just want you to be able to do whatever you want without getting pregnant or getting a disease. That's it. But God says it totally different. God says keep yourself pure and know how to possess your vessel and flee fornication, because God has something wonderful in store for you, and it's called marriage, and God has made it wonderful and blissful. And the reason why many of us look at marriages and we think marriage has got to be awful because everybody gets divorced. I'm telling you right now, after 21 years of marriage, not everybody gets divorced. My mom and daddy are 56 years into marriage. Not everybody gets divorced. And when you get married God's way and you do it God's way, and you stay with it God's way, you can have a wonderful life in marriage. The reason why many people got divorced when they got married is because they lived ungodly and in fornication before their marriage. So the world will try to flip your thinking. The world will try to tell you that even though you were born a boy, you didn't really, aren't really a boy. You can really be kind of whatever you want. And in fact, the United Nations passed years ago a resolution that they want to identify globally 6 different genders. And I understand we're afraid to speak on these kind of things, but it's everywhere today. The world wants to flip the script in your mind and tell you that there is a certain condition that you can be born with and a certain desire that you're born with, and you might be attracted to somebody of your same gender. Well, you know what? I don't deny that there are people who are attracted to people in their same gender, but there are also people that were attracted to steal my car. And it didn't make it right. Just because you have a desire for something doesn't mean that it's right. Just because you desire it, you're not God. Your desires are from a fallen nature. Your desires are sinful. There's a lot of things that you desire that you're not supposed to have. And what you need to do is get born again and then bring your desires and the lust of your flesh. That's what the word lust means. The desires of your flesh into subjection to the Holy Spirit. And then you'll desire God. But the world wants to flip the script on you. And let me show you how the devil does it. Number one, he will use emotional enticement. Did you notice in verse 5 and in other verses that when you hear all this music, the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harp, the dulcimer, the sackbut, all these different, all kinds of music. Do you know what music does? Music stirs your emotions. God made music. Good music stirs your emotions. That's why we tell you, young people, not to listen to the wrong kind of music, because the wrong kind of music affects the wrong kind of emotions and makes you desire and feel the wrong way. So then you begin to act on your emotions because of what you've been listening to. The world is all about touchy-feely and getting your emotions involved. That's why the radical left in this country who want to promote their agenda of same-sex marriage, they want to use the rainbow and they want to use this thing like hashtag love wins. They want everybody to love each other. What's wrong with everybody loving each other? Why can't we all just love each other? Well, that all goes really good in the world until somebody says, hey, that's wrong. And then they forget about loving each other anymore. Yeah. Now they want to put you under the prison. What the world will use is emotional enticement. They want to stir your emotions. That's why you can't listen to just anything you want to listen to. There are some of you that have emotions being stirred that don't need to be stirred. There are some of you right now, young ladies, there are some of you that deal with some deep hurts in your life. Your dad left your family. You've been in a broken home. You go through some serious emotional sadness. And then you listen to music that feeds that. That's like a guy who is suicidal getting help at the rope store. If you're a super sad person, you don't need to be listening to music that talks about cutting yourself. And music that makes you feel sad. Some of you have an anger problem. Some of you boys have an anger problem, and you listen to music that brings out, it's angry music. And you think that that music expresses how you feel. No, it is directing how you feel. If you don't believe that music has power, next time you listen to a scary movie or you watch something that's scary, turn the music off. It's a huge difference. We watched that skit a few minutes ago, and Moses and Abraham were telling us about owning it and the call for God, and they had music playing in the background. Let me tell you something. You take that music out, and it's a totally different video. Take a wedding and put all the music out of the wedding. It's a different wedding.
You're right, Richard. Exactly right.
They brought all kinds of music. All kinds of. The devil doesn't care if it's country or rap that moves you in the wrong emotions. It doesn't matter. They brought all kinds of music for all kinds of people because they wanted to stir the emotions of all the people. And they wanted to make this thing about worshiping this image an emotional experience. Yeah.
Number two, if that doesn't work, they use social inducement. That's a big word, but listen to what this is. Verse 2 and verse 3, then Nebuchadnezzar sent to gather all the princes, all the governors, all the captains, all the judges, and the treasurers, the counselors, the sheriffs, and all the rulers of the province to come to one place. He brought everybody, all the leaders, everybody socially was behind it. So I want to stir you emotionally. This is what the world does. The world wants to stir your emotions, and they want you to believe that everybody is involved. Society is going this way. It's the culture. And they want you to think that for you to step out and go against that is you going against everybody in the world. So the devil will use emotions, and then he'll use the social pressure that everybody's doing it. Everybody believes this way. We're the weirdos. We're the only ones that don't believe like this. The whole world believes this way. And you've got to fall in line. And if that doesn't work, now watch this. This is where we're moving. They've already tried. They're already trying all this emotional stuff. I mean, they'll say, Brother Randy, about a girl. Well, you know, she can have abortion because, you know, maybe it was a case of it was not her fault. Having a baby is going to make it hardship. What about the baby growing up in poverty and all these other things? So let's just remove the tissue. We can just abort the pregnancy. Let's put that into real terms for just a second, okay? How about somebody came to you and said, listen, you're not really doing very well in school. We're afraid that you're going to be a dropout and all that. So what we're going to do is we're just going to abort your teen years. We're going to abort you. I mean, think about that. It's like me going home saying, okay, sweetheart, listen, you know, this marriage thing's really not working out. I'm really afraid that we're going to have a hard time living together, and, you know, the two of us trying to, you know, me having to feed all of us, it's really hard on us, so I'm just going to abort you guys. And you're just a bunch of tissue anyway. So the world will use emotional things, and then when that doesn't work, listen, then that one doesn't work, then they're going to use society, like everybody's for this, you're the crazy one, and then if that doesn't work, look with me in verse number 6. And whoso falleth not down and worshipeth shall the same hour be cast into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. You know what that is? That is government enforcement. So if the emotions don't get everybody in line and putting the societal pressure, like society is going, the culture is going this way, everybody's thinking like this, if all that doesn't fall in line, then the government comes in and says, hey, guess what? You're going to do it or else. And then when that doesn't work, and by the way, let me just throw a thing real quick before I go to the fourth thing. If that doesn't work, the government is going to use things like mental illness. To be a Christian is you're mentally ill. It's a problem with your mind. So we have to medicate you. We have to put you in institutions. See, man, preacher, you're freaking me out. Now I'm going to show you in a minute how we're going to own it. See, the world, Nebuchadnezzar, what Nebuchadnezzar really said is, I am a God, and here's my image, and everybody's going to worship it. And he wanted to stir their emotions. And then when that didn't really work for these guys, then he was like, hey, everybody's here. Every leader, every judge, every sheriff, every province governor, everybody's here. So you guys got to get with the program, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. You're the only three not doing it. Everybody else is. And if you don't do it, I'm going to kill you. You're going in the fire. But let me tell you where they really get people. They get people when the emotional, societal, governmental, and let me tell you where they really get you, in the spiritual defilement. Verse number 6, they called it worshiping the image. They made this a spiritual thing. Young people, you listen to me right now. Everything that is called worship is not worship. And the devil is a master of creating something that makes you feel worshipful when you're really worshiping yourself. Well, I don't see what's wrong with this music. I mean, It just makes me feel so worshipful. Wait a minute. What does it make God feel like? Because singing this really wasn't for you, it's for Him. Everybody tracking with me right now?
Yes, sir.
So here are the emotions, the social, society, culture, the government, and now the spiritual, all the churches are on board. Wait till every church in town. You know, I mean, all of a sudden it's okay, Brother Danny. Churches are now offering same-sex weddings. Because we got to love each other. This is a way to express our love for God. Now it's spiritually defiled. Now you have preachers that come out and say, this is okay. See, you're coming into a new world, young people. Coming into a new age in America. It's never been like it is right now. And the climate is, we want to reach you emotionally. We want to make you feel the pressure socially. And if you don't get in line, the government's going to be behind it, making it mandatory and passing laws about it. And if that doesn't work, we want the churches to get aboard to make it a spiritual worship, part of our spiritual belief. So let me tell you what they did. Let me tell you how you can go out of here. You can go face the world and you can stand. How you can face the world and you can stand. How you can face the fire and stand for God. How you can own it. How you can own what God says in the real world. Number one, you have to have a settled faith.
Amen.
Look at verse 16. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer thee in this matter. Listen, they said, we're not worried to answer you. It's already settled in our heart. We've already settled what we believe. We've already settled that God is God, and we are His people, and we are the sheep of His pasture, and it is He that has made us, and not we ourselves. It's already settled in our heart that if God said it, we believe it. Listen to me, young people, look at me. There are some things that are going on in our world that if you're a Christian young person, they are not up for debate. God already settled the answer. And what you need to do is stand on that by faith and say, I'm going to rest myself on God's word, how God said it in God's way. And that's it. It's settled in my heart. Listen, I've already settled it in my heart that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He is the only way, the truth, the life. He is the only one that can bring salvation. He was born of a virgin. He lived 33 years sinless. He died on Calvary. He shed His rich royal blood. He went in the tomb. 3 days later, He came out alive. He ascended back to heaven. He's on the right hand of God. He put a Bible in my hand with every word in it. I'm going to believe it. This book is God's word. I'm going to stand on it. He's going to come back and get me one of these days. I'm going to live in glory forever and ever and ever. So while I'm here, it's already established. I'm going to live like I've got nothing to lose.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Is anybody with me right now?
Amen.
Number two, they had a settled faith. Number two, they had a strong faith. Verse 15, he said to them, What God will be able to deliver you out of my hands? In verse 17, they said, if it be so, our God will.
Right.
Now listen to me. I've got a strong faith. I'm not worried about the Muslims believing in Allah. Allah's not God.
Right.
He said, but bro, what about terrorists? What about ISIS? Well, what about Jesus? Because Jesus said it one of these days that the sword of his mouth is going to defile his enemies and devour them till their blood flows. And He is going to sit on His throne with His enemies as His footstool. He's going to be highly exalted. And I have to stand before Him and give an answer. Listen to me. I have faith. Muhammad did not come out of the tomb alive, but Jesus did. When the world wants to reject what we believe, we say, it was our God. It was our Savior. It's our way. We are right, young people. You know that? Some of you need to have a strong faith. You need to be able to go to school and stand for Jesus Christ. Number three, not only do they have a settled faith and a strong faith, but listen to me right here, young people. Here's where it is. They had a steadfast faith.
Amen.
Look at verse number 18. We know God's going to deliver us, but verse 18, what are the first three words? Say it out loud. What are the first three words?
Amen.
We know God can deliver us out of your hands, but if not. But if not, oh, listen,
man, I love to read my Bible and hear the stories of David and the other people. I remember going through the book of Hebrews one time, and I was reading the book of Hebrews, man, by faith, Enoch, by faith, Noah, by faith, Abraham, by faith. And man, I got down to the end of the chapter and said, man, time won't even permit me to tell about Samson and Jephthah and David and all these other men who subdued the mouths of lions, turned to flight the armies of the aliens. These men did mighty things. These men did great things. They received their dead to life again. Man, they were great. And then the Bible says, and others. Man, when I was reading that first part, I'm like, sign me up, man. I'm serving God. We're going to beat some lions. And then I got to, but others endured cruel mockings and trials and scourgings. They wandered in sheepskins and goatskins. They lived in the caves of the earth. They were sawn asunder. But they still believed. A steadfast faith is when you live for Christ in the good, but you live for Christ in the bad. You're with him on the mountain and you're with him in the valley. When you stand for God, when everything is good, it is a wonderful thing to praise God when you get a job, and it's great to praise him when you lose that job. Hey, listen to me. We have a steadfast faith. It's not always going to be easy. You're not always going to have an easy time. Church may not always be like this. There are nations of the world where people have to meet out of doors in some hidden location. They've got to get together in quiet groups. I remember reading several years ago about a group in Soviet Russia years ago. They would meet together in an abandoned warehouse, and the people would come together, and they would sneak one by one by one by one. They would gather in the room, and they would sit in that room. They would open their hymn books. They would sing in a whisper. Oh, Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder. They would sing. One day the Soviets came through that room and held those people at gunpoint and said, how many of you are there? And he said, there are 17 of us. They began to count the room. They said, but there's only 16. He said, yes, but Jesus is in our midst. There are 17 of us. Now, you hear me right now. I don't know what's coming in this world. I don't know what's coming down the line. But there needs to be some young people in this room that know that doesn't matter what happens in this world. Doesn't matter what the devil brings. Doesn't matter what the world believes. Doesn't matter how the pressure gets turned up. I don't care how upside down the world is. There ought to be some young people in here that say, bless God, by God's grace, I'm going to stand on this Bible, and I'm going to establish my faith in what God said, and I want God to give me strong faith. I want God to give me strong faith, and even if I have to face persecution and be the only one in my school that believes this way and be mocked and be laughed at and be ridiculed and mocked, bless God, I'm going to be steadfast and unmovable and always abounding in the work of the Lord. Amen. You be steadfast whether God delivers you or not. Let me tell you something about going to the fire. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they stood upright. Everybody bowed. They were bound, the Bible said. They were bound. In verse number 21, these men were bound in their coats, their hose, and their hats, and their other garments, and were cast in the midst of the fiery furnace. They were thrown in. But let me tell you what happens. Let me tell you, young people, you know what I believe, Brother Randy? Why I believe that the heat being turned up in the world is not a bad thing for the Christian? Let me tell you what happens in the fire. You know what happens in the fire? The saints get clean.
Yeah. That's good, preacher.
If you'll notice, when they came out of the fire, there was not any smell of smoke on their clothes.
Yeah.
But they came walking out. They were bound and cast in, but they came walking out in their clothes. Not the stench of smell. Not one hair was singed, and they came walking out. The only thing that was burned off in the fire were the ropes that they were tied up with, which tells me that when the saints get in the fire, the only thing that comes off of them is what the world put on them. When we go in the fire, God cleanses us. And let me tell you something, when the pressure gets up, it'll make you read your Bible. It'll make you pray. If you're standing alone in your school, it'll make you walk with God. It'll make you watch what you listen to, watch what you say, watch what you look at. It'll make you walk clean and upright and holy before God. We need some heat to cleanse the Christian. But not only that, Nebuchadnezzar looked in there and he said, I thought we threw in three. There are four. And that fourth one looks like the Son of God. Oh, Paul knew what he was talking about. Because Paul said, he said, oh, that I may know him and the fellowship of his sufferings. Do you know what happens? Not only does the Christian get clean, but listen, there's fellowship with the Savior. Man, when you get into trouble, Jesus shows up. Do you know, listen to me, young people, look at me. Did you know that Jesus did not save you to get you out of trouble? He saved you to get into trouble with you. He saved you to get into trouble with you. If you'll take a stand for Jesus Christ, he'll stand with you. I can see those boys fall in that fire, ready to be burned up. They didn't burn. And they stood up. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego looked at each other. He said, are you hurting? He said, nah, it feels good. And they turned around, and the Lord walked in and said, hey, fellas, heard you guys got in a little bit of trouble. Saw you taking a stand out there. You mind if I pull up a chair? They said, no, Lord, pull up a chair. Jesus sat down with them and said, Shadrach, I saw you take a stand. I know you were afraid. I know you were worried, but you were strong in the Lord and of good courage. He said, I got a reward for you. He said, how about you, Meshach and Abednego? You men stood for God. You stood with each other. I know what you were thinking. You were thinking that if Meshach would have fallen down, you would have fallen down. But Meshach, you stayed standing. And Shadrach, you stayed standing. And Abednego, you stayed standing. And you encouraged each other. And you loved each other. And you helped each other. And I'm with you here. He said, here, have some graham crackers and some crackers and some marshmallows. We'll have some s'mores. And when you get in the fire, Jesus will come in the fire and have s'mores with you. And then we'll say this. Not only does the Christian get clean and Jesus get close, but I'll tell you what else happens. Sinners get convicted. Look at verse 29. Nebuchadnezzar said, therefore, I make a decree that every people, nation, and language would speak anything amiss against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be cut in pieces, and their houses shall be made a dunghill, because there is no other God that can deliver after this sort. Nebuchadnezzar, I believed in the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He got convicted. He got converted because they took a stand for Christ. Now, you listen to me. Some of you young people need to walk out of here, and you're a Christian. You're different from the world. You have a different birth. You're living in a world of once-born people, and you're twice-born people. They're on their way to hell. You're on your way to heaven. You've got Jesus living in you. They're in the bondage of their sin. You're different. Act different. Walk different. Talk different. Live different. And live for Christ. And be obedient to God's word. And own this book. And live in it. And let it live in you. Get it in your heart. Walk with Jesus every day. Take a stand for Jesus Christ. And learn to live with him. Live gloriously. Live victoriously. Live powerfully. In one of these days, Jesus himself will sit with you and say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. And you know, the big old bad Nebuchadnezzar and the big old bad empire of Babylon thought that these three little kooky boys were facing extinction. The truth of the matter was, Nebuchadnezzar and Babylon are gone. And the name of our God still lives. You know, Brother Miller, the church is dying. Well, there's some dead churches. But the church has never been more alive than it is right now. Jesus said, Brother Randy, Upon this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And you know what that means, young people? Listen to me. Do you know what that means? Nobody ever went to battle and took their gates to battle to fight with their gates. Hell is not trying to beat the church with its gates. Hell is not attacking the church. Nor is the church attacking hell, and those gates can't stand against us, and we're going to break through. Why do we want to have hell anyway? What the Bible's teaching there is this, that this world is the hell that the Bible's talking about is the domain of the dead. It's where the dead go. They're already dead in their trespasses and sins. This world is the domain of the dead. And where is this world on its way to? Hell. You know what Jesus said? He said, listen to me. In the middle of this dead world, I'm going to plant my church. And the gates of hell cannot prevail against it. Listen to me. It means this, that the domain of the dead is not going to keep the church here. The church is breaking out of here, and it's going to go live with Jesus forever.
Come on now. Come on.
Amen.
I had an old man in my church that was a farmer. And in Mississippi, they raise catfish. Okay? Everybody raises catfish. So catfish get in every pond. Well, he wanted a pond that he could raise some tilapia and some other kind of fish that he could sell. Well, he had a big old catfish in there. And so all these things, he would always introduce the tilapia into his ponds as these little minnows. And this catfish would swim around and just eat all his minnows. He could never get the tilapia to grow in that pond. So he did some research. And he found out, Brother Randy, that there is a little fish. It's a little tiny fish. And it has a special thing that it likes to do. The way it survives is it lets a bigger fish eat it. And then from the inside, it eats the bigger fish. So he said, I'm going to fix this old catfish. So he got him one of them little minnows. That's how you say it in Mississippi. One of them little minnows. And he pitched it in the pond there with all his little tilapia. And that big old catfish just went around, opened his mouth. He's just swimming around there eating up all them little minnows. And he swallowed that little minnow. And so that little minnow just got in the belly, like, no problem. All the other ones are like, ah, we're going to die. They're freaking out. That little minnow's like, hey, guys, this is awesome. Watch this. And he just starts eating away. And he just eats a hole right in the side of that catfish. And all the mother minnows are like, whoa. And they all swim out. And before long, that catfish would still be able to swim for a little while. But in a few days, that catfish was going to be belly up. And that little minnow was going to pick it clean. You see, when man sinned in the Garden of Eden, death began to gobble men up.
Wow.
And death has just been gobbling everybody up. Everybody that lives dies. I'm going to die. You're going to die. Death has just been swimming around for 6,000 years, gobbling everybody up. But one day, death swallowed the wrong man.
Yeah, man.
And he went in, but he came back out alive. And he opened a door in death and said, I am the way to everlasting life. He that believeth in me, though he liveth, he though he die, shall never die. He said, believest thou this? I am the way, I am the life, I am the truth. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Young people, listen to me. We're on our way to heaven. We're on the winning side. We're living in the church. We're part of what God's doing in this world. You need to own it. Go back home and get involved. Win souls to Christ. Run the bus route. Live for Jesus. Sing in the choir. Live godly. Say no to sin. Do something for God. We're on the winning side. It's not us that's facing extinction. The world's facing extinction. We're on the winning side. Stand for Jesus. Our heads are bowed. Lord,